and welcome to our second Friday night of ATX TV Festival season 10, something I can't quite wrap my head around. I'm Caitlin McFarland, co-founder of the festival. And as a lot of you know, we're normally 4 days in Austin in June. And this year my partner pitched 10 days for season 10. It's one of the many things that a virtual festival is allowing for. And it has been so very exciting to share such a wide range of series and conversations with everyone all week. And we're kicking this weekend off with another incredible show. So sometimes words lose meaning to me. We say incredible, exciting, amazing far too often, but please believe me that there are no words to really tell you how hard and how fast we felt for Work in Progress. Somehow we missed its launch and it was our partners at Showtime telling us about it that led us to going all in. If you haven't watched it, I'm jealous because you have all of season one available to watch now and season two on the way. And I don't even want to tell you all the feelings I have for Abby and her whole world. Kind of want her to be my best friend. I'm sure it would be very complicated and problematic, but I know we would laugh a lot. Please, please, please give this show your attention. Check it out. Allow us to be the place that launched this beautiful series into the ether. We want to be the reason you discovered it and share it with everyone you know. So with that, I'm going to stop rambling and just say, please watch, share and tag ATX Festival. We want credit. It's not all about that, but it kind of is. So I'm going to stop and introduce your moderator to bring out this amazing group so you can be smitten too. For the first time at ATX, Trish Bendix from the New York Times.
Thank you so much for having me, ATX. I've always wanted to come, so this is amazing and can't wait to come in person. I am so thrilled to be here to talk with the cast and some of the crew of Work in Progress, which is one of the most incredible shows on television right now. Everyone that I talked with about this panel was so jealous and excited. Season two, we just can't wait to see what's going to be happening on this show. I think it's one of the few shows that really nails what queer and trans people, the kind of dark comedy that we live every day. And I think it's very relatable for a lot of different people. So with that, I would like to introduce, all right, let's start with director Yance Ford. All right, then let's say co-creator and star Abby McEnany.
Hi.
Executive producer Lilly Wachowski. Hello. Writer Samantha Irby.
Hi.
And star Celeste. Oh God. I totally forgot. Please say it correctly so I don't.
Pechous.
I like wrote it. I'm so sorry. It was great. Hey, to talk about it. It was all the talk about it. Oh my God. So great start. We've all been able to watch season one and we're going into season two. So I'd love to sort of bridge what, you know, what people last saw with the show, which kind of ended on a little bit of a dark note for a show that has, you know, both ends, the comedy and the darkness. So what was it like going into the room and planning for season two and deciding where you're going to pick up after sort of that very dark moment for Abby?
Lilly and I, like during the shoot, we'd be like, hey, remember February 4th, 2020, when we started this thing? Like, it's so weird. Lilly, I don't even remember. Sam was there. She'll be like, they were a mess.
you were.
I think we knew that, like, we wanted to follow Abby's journey of finding herself and self-worth without a partner, maybe? Honestly, my mind is Swiss cheese. What do you think, Lilly?
Well, we were very tired.
Yes. we just wrapped up, we wrapped a week ago, and I think I'll speak for myself, but I'm walking around like a zombie still, so. But I think that, I don't know, what do you think?
Yeah.
So far, this is going great, right, Trish?
Yeah, I'm getting a lot of
people are like, I definitely want to tune into that.
I know, should we start over?
Oh, they're going to love it.
It's hard to say, you know, because we wrapped right before the holidays. We wrapped post on season one and we didn't have a lot of time to like refill the pond. And so we all sort of came into the room and, you know, we started putting up note cards on our board and just coming up with all the, and like went through all of our piles of note cards from the previous season that didn't quite it didn't quite make it into season one. And so there were quite a few little fragments of things that we were able to start, you know, building a story out of. I mean, the thing that was most important to us is what Abby was saying, that we didn't just want to retell the first season by rehashing a another love story. It's like, I think like a lot of the things that I like to do is attack those kinds of paradigms that we all, these scripts that we're given in narratives and in life, like this idea that you have to be, have a partner to be happy in life. And it's like, you know, that's not necessarily true, because there are lots of meaningful relationships that you can have and nourish yourself with. And so we wanted to concentrate on that. I wanted to like try to do what I could to like dismantle the nuclear family and the ideas about nuclear family. And like, I think the ideas of queer family does that. And so that was another thing that we were focused on doing. Hail Satan!
Yes! Exactly.
That's a big theme in this season.
Yeah, right.
I mean, love that.
We did have an episode 11, but they were like...
Okay, so, you know, there's so many fun characters, obviously Celeste playing one of them, that in Abby's world, you know, there's so many different people, like your relationship with your sister, you know, so how does the writer's room work with all these brilliant characters that populate Abby's life?
Well, it was really fun to go back in, because we actually got to have writers this year, which was awesome, and it was really fun to see the characters that really resonated with the folks in the room, and Campbell is certainly one of them. I think Celeste, I think that, like you said, like that people have asked you like, did you just meet Abby, and it's like, no, we've been friends for 25 years, and there's a trust I have for Celeste, and a love and I don't know, just joy I have. So like, it was really fun. And then, really coming into the people that weren't around last year and seeing who they resonated with, like who in Abby's like family bio and, chosen, you know, I think, Campbell, certainly one of them, Susan, who was Mary, Abby's boss at work, Mary Sohn was one of them. King, played by Armand Fields, was one of them. Mike, played by Jerry Nugent, who's plays my brother-in-law, is what, you know, I mean, and then like my, you know, my niece, nephew, like, I mean, every, like people in the family, I would say. Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah,
it was weird to come.
Oh, yeah, just go ahead. I want to say, Sam, go ahead.
It was weird to come into the, not weird, but interesting. Interesting is a better word than weird. To come into the room as a fan and have ideas about these people on this show and present them to the people in the show. I think it's weird for everybody to be like, so I was thinking that this person should do this, and like watch the color drain out of their faces as they're like, no, did you understand the show you watched the first season? Not doing that. But like, it's, I will say that when we first started, there were a couple of big beats already like on the board and worked out. And that was very helpful to me as, you know, a person who was new to the show, to be like, okay, this is sort of loosely what we're gonna do. And then we get to have a little fun, you know, but all my pitches got rejected. So
that is absolutely, that is 100% bullshit. You're such a fucking...
So I don't know what you're going to see, because they didn't like any of my ideas, which I guess is like...
And she took them all to Sex in the City. So
yeah, so wait till you see that next season. No. You're going to be like, oh, Sam was out of her mind. Pitch this to them. So, but no, it's because you think it's going to be not, or you think it's going to, like, people are going to be hostile when you're coming into their territory and being like, hey, I know you didn't, you weren't going to do this, but what if you did do this? Like, it, that's like a scary thing. And Abby and Lily were like open to all of our deranged ideas. I can't wait for you to see them. Some of the stuff that like we're getting away with, I think is very exciting. I'm excited for people to see it.
Yeah, I mean, it must be a little interesting to write for someone who is, you know, a thinly veiled version almost of Abby. So you're bringing in something and saying, Abby, this will somewhat reflect you no matter what, you know, the truth of this is. So Abby, have you ixnayed things based on just not wanting to have to do those or have those tied to you as the person?
Ooh, I think there were like when we started with season one, there were just two issues that I talked to Lily and Tim, who was with us season one, that were like not like non-starters, like just two things, like because I weirdly enough I'm very private, which doesn't track, but it's true. And then there was something like this sex scene last year. Oh God, I still have nightmares about it. Like I didn't want to do that. And then made that through. So like I don't think I've really like stepped away. But Lily, maybe I'm being false about that. I think this season, the gift, and like Lily said, like the pond was dry. I mean, we were still on the air. Like we were a week off, like after our finale when we started writing, and there wasn't really, we didn't have time to heal and rest and like kind of regroup. So the gift of having six brilliant writers come in and like, and throw out all these great ideas and be like, whoa, this is so cool. And then also I was so protected. Hopefully I think the main thing about this, I hope the main thing is that Lily and I think our number one goal is to create a safe, honest space and like that there's room for discussion and disagreement, but learning and like, and not everyone has to be on the same, like, you know, not everybody has to agree on everything, but there has to be respect and safety and stuff like that. So I felt absolutely protected in that room. And there were times where I'd be like, I just need to step out. Cause it's a lot, you know, like I think I still haven't come to terms with that. I have, there's a television show with a character named Abby McEnany who is very much like me. And I haven't really, you know, I don't really get it. And I think, so it gets overwhelming at times. And I would leave that room and feel absolutely safe that like, first of all, I'd be able to know what was talked about and still have a say, but that they were taking care of me. And that's just an incredible gift. And I don't know if that answered your question, but
Totally. I mean, so season one, you were able to put together before you could really have anybody say, you know, make any comments about it. And obviously most people love this show, but the queer community can be some of the harshest critics on our own content. And so I'm wondering going into season two, you know, if there was any sort of, and I know Abby, you like stay off social media and stuff, so maybe this was to your benefit, but was it hard to go into season two without having any sort of like people having expectations or really wanting to see Theo back or like having wants now from you? And, you know, was that at any part of the storytelling process for you this season?
I'll start, but like Lily, you can, I mean, if you want it, but I would say, I honestly, I know that there's a lot of stuff out there. I don't hear any of it. I know there's a lot of stuff from within the community that is angry and stuff. I'm like, first of all, I'm happy to hear that, but I'm not interested in changing our story or point of view just to make somebody happy and not being true to ourselves. I think the gift of having you know, writers in this year is that I want to hear if we're doing something wrong or if something's bumping somebody or it's like, oh, I don't know why you're telling that story and maybe somebody else should be telling it. I'm always open to those conversations, but like the second that you start changing your art because somebody is saying that they didn't like it. I mean, I've read some comments on like an interview I did that talks about the way that they talk about something I said. I'm like, I never said that. And that's absolutely false. And it's just like, I don't know. I'm definitely open to conversations, but just like vitriol, it brings nothing of interest to me. And I think once it shuts down your creative stuff, then like, how does anybody leave their house and create, you know? And that isn't to say, I'm open to conversation about what stuff I do wrong. Cause I fuck up all the time. And all of my friends on here would tell me that. And I'm not saying I want to hear that, but just, I don't know.
We'll have a call after this.
I know. I mean, honestly, sometimes I'm like, Sam, you can only have 8 hours of my time this week. But anyways, Lily, what would you say to that? I don't know if I answered that right.
I don't know. I don't engage. I don't like publicity. I don't like doing press. So there's not a lot of interactive, even like in my Twitter account, I just pretend that it's radio. We're going to another broadcast. So,
I mean, to be clear, I didn't see any like a ton of negative stuff or anything. I'm just curious about, you know, people always have ideas. They're like, oh, I would love this to happen. You know, I'd love if Campbell and Abby hooked up. You know, like, do you take any of that stuff into consideration?
I mean, there is like a thing that it's like you have, there are expectations that audiences have, and you can play on those expectations. And you, I guess you can do that in like improv as well. Like if the audience is being a certain way, then you can sort of change the way that your performance is going. And so I kind of like that aspect. Like I know that there's this ton of, you know, why aren't Campbell and Abby together? And so I like to like take all that expectation and like, just manipulate that a little bit. I think that that's kind of fun because they're creating this expectation about these two characters that isn't there. They are this queer family. And, you know, one of the early scenes that like we never got to shoot was this scene where Abby and Campbell like practice making out early in their relationship, and they finish and they're like, okay, you want to go get something to drink? And it's just, you know, that's the essence of their relationship to me. And it's like, not necessarily romantic, but very familial.
You're ride or die.
Yeah. And I would add to that, like, and I just think that those things like, oh, I hope they end up together. Like that just goes in the trope that like, that romance or like, you know, a passionate romantic relationship is more valuable and more meaningful to human beings than like somebody who's fucking like there 1,000%. And I fucking hate that trope. I believe my life, I've been single a long time and I'm thrilled about it. Like, I don't I wish I had a partner. I'm like, oh man, my autonomy. Ooh wee. So I don't know. I hate that fucking, I hate that sort of like, well, why aren't they together? It's like, because there are a lot of best friends that have never fucked and don't want to fuck. And they're there for each other for the rest of their lives. And they can call them in the middle of the fucking night and they'll go cross country to save them. I don't know. Woo, I got a little, I should mute.
No, that's why Work in Progress is so amazing. You know, it's so different from most of those shows that have to be driven by some sort of romantic situation. So I appreciate it. I think a lot.
It's just boring. I mean, I just like, this is, I'm sorry, Trish, did I cut you off?
No, that's
okay. I think like, you know, anything I've heard like, you know, 18th hand that there's some people like, well, why don't they do this? I'm like, God bless. Yeah, no one show can do everything.
Right.
And God, like make a show or like, you know, start working towards that. Find people that you want to create with and start fucking making a show. And I know like that, again, there's so many things that we've wanted to tackle in the first season and second season. There's only, I mean, there are characters, there's limited space. Like we have this year, we have 10, like, I don't know, 27 minute episodes. It's a lot of like, once I was able to talk to Lily about it and just like kind of we can't carry that burden. We carry a lot of burdens and I, you know, we can't tell every story. And there's some stories that I shouldn't be, that are not for me to tell, you know?
I think it's also a really great to break assumptions. People are going to assume that Abby and Campbell are going to hook up and then it doesn't happen. So I'm like, you know, all in for breaking assumptions. The relationship that Campbell and Abby have, hopefully we all have that in our life. And it's such a special, beautiful relationship. And And I think, you know, cause yeah, like Ab said, a lot of people are like, are you and Abby gonna hook up? And and I'm always like, you know, do you hook up with all of your best friends, right? Uh-huh. And so it's a beautiful relationship to explore the many dynamics that a relationship like Campbell and Abby even have, going back, you know, a couple decades of life together. And that's pretty hardcore, lasting longer than some also romantic relationships. Mm-hmm. So it's fun to explore.
And there's some queerness in there too of a queer relationship. Like they've hooked up in the past, but there was no romance. Like, I don't know, like, you know, it's not this like, you know, oh, if you hooked up once, you're always in love with that person. It's just like, no. Like, I mean, I think there's just a queerness of like, yeah, sometimes you do stuff and it doesn't, I don't know.
True. Yeah, exactly. And that's what people really like about Work in Progress, I think. I was just curious if, you know, how you handled going into season two after having feedback. So you answered my question perfectly.
Yeah. And also it's funny because I didn't hear a lot of the feedback.
Yeah. Don't resign from it. You're like, no, don't talk to me about this show. I love it. So let's talk about the directing, bring Yance in here. I'd love to know a little bit about, you know, you're coming on to be a part of the project and what you thought of the first season and how, you know, you saw yourself fitting into this group.
Sure. Well, I loved the first season, and I, you know, I heard about it from a friend who was like, you have to watch the show right now. And you know, I was just so excited that that there was this queer world that had been created that felt so authentic and so genuine and so loving and so complicated and real. I was just happy that it was on, you know, TV where people could see it and stream it and watch it over and over again. And, you know, I was just so excited, you know, that it existed in the world and that it exists in the world. Cause I feel like there can never be enough of that, you know, in all of its iterations. I met Lilly in January at the last Sundance Film Festival before COVID shut everything down, and made the connection and tried not to completely fan out and, you know, like be a total dork about it. But I may have slipped into some conversation somewhere that I was, you know, a big fan of Work in Progress and looking to move into scripted. And then when it actually happened, I was like, wait, what? They want me to literally, I was like, is there another like Nancy Ford who somehow had a conversation with the Showtime guy and Lily and Abby and you know, they said yes to that person because this person is in shock. You know, like I was just like, what? So but immediately like Abby and Lily invited me into this world. You know, like when I got all of the scripts to read and just had this sense of how different season two is from season one, but just how rich and exciting and real and emotional and, you know, just confrontational and just there were so many things going on. That, you know, we were asked to send back a list of our top four, I think it was, maybe top three. And I think I sent back a list of six, you know, and I had two episodes tied for first place. And, you know, it was just an incredible process. And then when I was assigned the episodes eight and nine, which are, you know, and I have to say, I just, you know, just stepping back as a director, Abby is in like, almost every scene in both of the episodes that I directed. And it was such a privilege and just a real, you know, just once in a lifetime experience to be able to watch Abby go over the arc of the emotional trajectory of both of these episodes and show up like every single take, every single time. It was just like, There were certain scenes that we shot where my head literally just went afterward because Abby's performance is so incredible. And I just feel so lucky to to be a part of this, you know, spectacular season. I think that people are going to be really moved by it. I think people are going to be really challenged by it. And I got to play a little part, you know, in it. And, you know, it's just, it's a really great thing because it's so good. You know, it's just so good. Like when I kept saying I've seen the episode, but when what I meant to say was I read the script, you know, and so it's like I read these scripts and they were so vivid and they were so there and the writing was so good. And I was just like, I can see what these things, you know, need to be, what they're striving to be, with the length that's so precise, it's so deliberate. All of it was just an incredible thing to see pre-production. And then actually to be in the production of it was a whole nother, like I said, feeling really fortunate to be a part of this great thing.
Amazing. I loved watching Abby's face as you give her compliments.
No, it was great. I mean, having you know, like being able to talk to Abby and Lilly beforehand was amazing. I got to hear from the showrunner. I got to hear from, you know, from the star and you know, the creator of the series, what the episodes meant to each of them, and to have that information prior to going into directing the episodes, it was just like I had this North Star that I always could fix myself to. It's like, oh, I know that this, like this episode is a love letter to Abby's dad. And like, oh, I know that this episode is about like this one moment that is, I won't give it away, but that's just like, just this magnificent thing that happened. It's been an incredible experience.
Wow.
I wanna pop in real quick too. Samantha, I've never met you in person. But so
I know I'm a lot about you and have thought a lot.
But I want to pop off of what Yancey said as he directed episode 8, which was written by Samantha. When I read that, it was one of the most beautiful scripts and episodes I've ever read. Ever. And it's one of those that just off the page, it does. It glows. I got goosebumps from it. It's brilliant.
That's all Lilly. Lilly and I did that together. Any of the glowing,
sorry, Lilly.
Any of the glowing good parts.
Take a little credit, Sam. For God's sake.
A very little credit. I mean, I was gonna say that it was an honor for them to have me.
Right. Yeah. That was about saying, really.
Like, I mean, Yance is really amazing by giving them all the credit, but I walked in like, you're lucky I said yes.
That is not a lie.
I did not.
She was
girls. I mean, I listened to your Abby and Sam, your conversation for the Chicago Humanities Festival.
Oh my God, you did?
I did. I did the homework. You know, I still got my 312 number. I got my Chicago ties. Okay. So Abby, you said that you had wanted to get Sam for the first season to write for the show, but it just didn't work out because she was too booked and busy. And then you didn't really have the budget because she's so expensive. So,
I don't set the rate that I have a fancy
for people LA guy do, for people.
Yeah.
And it wasn't even that. It's like we actually, when we started writing, we actually didn't have a deal. So there was zero money. It didn't matter how much anybody cost. But she's pricey and you deserve every penny.
Wow.
Don't sell yourself short, Sam Irby.
So then you got her for season 2. So how did that happen?
A lot of tears.
Can I tell them about I had an interview, right? And like Abby and Lilly FaceTimed me and I didn't know, I got nervous. I didn't know what to expect. And then I was like, wait, are we doing this over like FaceTime on my little busted phone? And that immediately took the stress down. And so I answer and they're on and they're just like giggling at me and I'm like giggling at them. And after a few minutes of that, they were like, well, we just want to make sure you weren't like that you were a real person. Do you want this job? And I was like, yes, I would, you know, I would do anything to have that job. And it was like, it was very easy. And then I went to Chicago and it was amazing. The room was really great. It's so, I mean, one of the things about like TV is you get thrown into a room with a lot of people and like, they don't ask me who else they should hire, right? So you're walking in and you don't know who you're gonna be working with or what the vibe is gonna be like. And like truly the first day I was like, oh, everyone in here is the same kind of idiot that I am. All we do is bits all day. I don't know how, honestly, like when I think about the room, I'm like, how did we get any work done? Because all I remember is like eating lunch and making jokes. I couldn't tell you what happens in the season. Like I watched the tape read and I was like, oh, okay, yeah. Cause mostly we were just like truly making fun of each other the whole time. And it was the kind of like room, not to get too, you know, fruity about it, but it was the kind of room where you're like, oh my God, this is like magical that all these people could be here together and they genuinely like each other and we genuinely love the thing we were making. Yeah. It's not every experience. But it was, and you can feel like how intentional that is, which is, I mean, Abby was talking earlier about feeling safe. And one of the, I mean, it's weird to make a story about a person who's sitting in the room with you. It's, you know, it's, I don't want to offend her. I don't want to put her in a weird position or anything like
that. Oh, shit.
Y'all were thinking that. I mean, I will offend you later, but I don't want to offend you in front of people. And they just created like such a good environment, and it was great.
I love
Please
that.
Please watch the show so we can do it again.
Oh, yeah.
And so I can raise my rate for next year.
Well, you did throw Sam in that same conversation that you were going to come, you were going to write yourself in potentially if you came with a character idea. So did that ever come to fruition? Are you on the show?
No, I can't believe I said that. We were drinking during that.
Oh, interview, okay.
Which is why I said, no, if I could turn my camera off for this, I would. I don't ever want to be filmed doing anything. But I mean, maybe season 3, Abby will have a date with a sassy black lady.
Oh my God, Sam. I'll write that episode with Lilly.
Yeah. Yes.
Thank you, Celeste.
The fans want it. Now you have to listen to the fans because I'm the fan.
Celeste, reference. You're going to get an Emmy for that.
Yes, I'm certain.
So, you know, I would love to touch on how COVID affected anything for you all. Filming, I'm assuming, were you doing that during COVID? And, you know, what kind of things and precautions did you have to take? Did it affect anything? Were you not able to shoot something you wanted to the way you know, no crowd scenes? Like, so what was it like?
COVID hit right as we were finishing writing. Mm. And so we had this super great, super intense time together. And then had to like wrap it up like the last week where we were all doing it remotely. And then we took a month off, sort of processed what was going on in the world. I mean, even now you can still feel the horror that is unfolding with this pandemic. It's just, it keeps going on and on and on. And, you know, you had this sense that there was like a lot of material that was like being generated where, you know, people would be, you know, they'd make all these Zoom jokes and stuff like that. And we were like, there's something that is like completely tone deaf about that because, you know, what is happening in the world and just like the fallout was unquantifiable at the time. And I think it still is. Here we are over a year later. And so we had to like somehow incorporate the pandemic into the storyline. And what was good about the way that we chose to
to do that was not by making the pandemic a focus and not make it a focus towards Abby, because we had like so many major things already happening that we would just, we brought in COVID as this sort of backdrop and then worked our way around it. And then, you know, our show sort of climaxes around like COVID coming, but especially around the murder of George Floyd. And so like that is like where our, you know, the end of our show takes place. And so it was really, really hard to write about. Like it just, who wants to write about this stuff? And so there was like a lot of just like, glutural stuff coming out onto the pages, and we were able to get a lot of rage and fire and hold up a mirror to, you know, the world and, you know, white supremacy and capitalism and all this stuff. And and then we were meant to start shooting in the summer, and the pan, because our show is so, we're just like, everything is held together with like spit and tape. There's like, you know, we're really a low budget production, and we're all location based. So the all of the logistics of like how the unions were working out how to film were just beginning to start being set up. Mm-hmm. And we didn't feel like our show was the kind of show that could be one of the first shows that got back into production. And so we extended our hiatus until February, and okay, like reworked the scripts one more time. And so, and then it's like COVID tests every day and like social distancing and, you know, ADs walking around with 6-foot sticks, like to separate people. And you're walking around with your N95 diaper on your face the whole day. It was horrible, because it's like this job is, it's one of the hardest jobs ever. And you have to, I have to be able to express joy and receive joy. And you can't do that without your fucking mouth.
Lily would go, I'm smiling under my mask.
Can you tell how much I love you? I think you're really great.
And then she'll take it off, smiling with her eyes. Yeah. And then,
yeah. And then if things weren't going great, guess what I'm doing with my mouth. But I would add to that COVID thing, like, I think that's right. Like we put, and then, you know, it was so early on and who knew what was happening. And then they're like, are you gonna put COVID in the show? And my original response is absolutely not. Like, I have no interest in writing a show about COVID. I have no interest in acting in a show about COVID. I'm barely, like, honestly, I'm not leaving the house. It was not a good time for, I'll speak for myself, my mental health. Like, I was terrified. There were some people like, oh, it'd be really great, do a whole thing about how you wash your hands. I'm like, that is a fucking nightmare. You're trivializing my OCD. Like, you're trivializing mental health. It is not a dream come true. Like, and I'm just not, honestly, and I'm not interested in watching that. But like, you know, obviously as it went on and it makes sense. So I think the way we did it was like, yeah, because our show is based in reality. Like it's a real show about real fucking people that you don't often see on television, right? So I think the way that we did it, I think it's, I'm very proud of the way that we did it. And it's sort of just, you see it, but it's not really like, oh, what's Abby gonna do when she washes her hands? Like, and then I'm so glad we had like 3 different start dates last year. And like, we were like, Lily and I did not want to be the first ones back. Like, again, like she said, like our budget's so small. We don't have the, like, and we're so like, she, like we're, it's, yeah, it's spit and sweat and love. I think that keeps the show going, you know? And so once we were told finally that we weren't going to shoot until this year, I got to say, like, I was actually able to kind of breathe at, like for the first time in a long time. And we sent in our scripts. I think the next week, like Lilly and I had one more week and then we sent them in and then we had a couple of meetings, but that was like, that for me, that summer was like very healing. Like I was still recovering from season one, you know? Anyways, so I'm thrilled. It was very difficult. I was very terrified. The way that I think, I felt very safe on set and I'm very grateful. And also, like, you know, all these shows were being canceled, even shows that had been renewed started getting canceled. I'm like, oh my God, we're gonna get canceled. Oh my God. And I'm so grateful that we got to shoot and create and be with these wonderful people that you see on screen and mm-hmm. whew. But yeah, it's rough. It was rough. And even the lack of like seeing like my best friend Celeste and not being able to hug her. But then we'd be in a scene together and we're like, I mean, we're gonna hug in a scene, right?
Right. Yeah. Yeah, Nancy, I mean, what was that like to direct during COVID?
It was a challenge. I mean, for me with the mask over my face, I was just like, nobody can hear me under this fucking mask, first right. of all. No one can hear me. So I spent like half of the time pulling it away from my face just a little bit, trying to shout as loudly as I could and then letting it snap back into place for anybody like was like on my case about, you know, about breaking the rules. It was, you know, because so much of what's happening in these scenes and in the two episodes that I directed, it's so emotional, there's so much human connection. And to not be able to have most of your face when you're trying to talk to somebody about, you know, like an adjustment in a performance, or, you know, even locking was more difficult because of the masking and the social distancing and making sure there aren't too many people on set and just, you know, and I absolutely understand why we have all these protocols and you know, I'm grateful for them, but it does put a barrier that you have to figure out, you have to think your way around the barrier, and it means just, you know, I think it just made me have to try to communicate more and to, you know, and to talk more more explicitly about what I was hoping to get from each performance and from each of the actors.
Well, it seems we have time for one more question. I want to end on the COVID note. So I'd love to, is there, just to test you, one thing that you can say that you're excited for people for to see in season two that's not too spoilery. So is there anything in particular that you know, you explored, a theme, just a fun scene that not too spoilery, but that, you know, just isn't a little enticing?
This is enticing for me. I don't know if it's enticing for anybody else, but Celeste and I get to do some scenes in a car. Those are my favorite. So it's like, I mean, that's not very enticing, but those are my favorite to shoot because, like, I mean, she's a goof. Anyway, that was dumb.
No, that's great.
And I'm gonna piggyback on that. All right, driving scenes with abs is amazing. Also, I was challenged this year. I'm not gonna say if it has anything to do with the hot dog or not. No spoilers. But the driving scenes, I got to tell you though, in between takes, I laughed till I cried working with Abby. I'm so excited for people to see season two. It does explore a whole different side. And Abby is legitimately one of my heartbeats. You know what, Trish? You're going to see pure joy.
Aww.
You're going to see genuine love. And I hope that comes across between everyone on set, from behind the scenes to in front of the scenes. It's such a cool, amazing, passionate crew and cast. And I really do think that that's going to come across in season two. And that's something that I'm really excited for people to see.
We get to explore Abby's world much more non-linearly. We get to go back into the past a lot more, and we get to go into Abby's subconscious a lot more.
There is an otherworldly cameo that I can't wait for people to see.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Yancy, anything you wanna?
I agree with all of the above.
Amazing. Well, I'm so excited. I know everybody else that loves the show is too. So thank you so much. Watch Work in Progress. We're excited.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Trish. Thank you.